torment as well. But Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets, that means the Old Testament, let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. Abraham said to him, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, Old Testament, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. Here's the next lesson. If you won't listen to the Bible, you won't listen to a miracle either. Remember, this story is being told to the Pharisees. Later, Jesus would raise a different Lazarus from the dead right in front of the eyes of the Pharisees. A person did rise from the dead, Lazarus, and they still were plotting how to kill Jesus. So when somebody says, well, I would just believe in Jesus if he'd give me a miracle, not necessarily. Listen, everybody's had a million miracles. I mean, the air we breathe, the complex human body in which we live, this incredibly complex put-together universe, how many miracles do you need? So when people say, well, if he'd give me one more, I'd believe. I don't believe it. If people will not listen to Moses and the prophets, they're not going to listen to a miracle. The Pharisees didn't. I mean, I have a buddy, Jeff, who's an agnostic, and he said to me, well, if God would just give me a fiery vision, I'd believe in him. Well, God's already given you many evidences of his existence. You'd just say hallucination if you got a vision. So, let me share now. We're at the end of the parable. Actually, we don't know if it's a parable. It could be a parable. He could be talking about two real people. We're not sure. But here's the main lesson. The rich man went to hell because of what he did and didn't do with his money. I have a pastor friend who preached on money last week. And after church, I was talking to him about it, and I said to him, I think money is where the rubber meets the road in the Christian life. And when somebody says to me, oh, I love Jesus so much, part of me wants to ask, can I see your checkbook? Is there any evidence in your checkbook that you love Jesus? And somebody could say, well, but Pastor, we're saved by grace alone, not by what we do. I agree. But it's also true, again, when we're saved by grace alone, that changes us. It makes me love God. It makes me want to be generous with my money and care about the salvation of the soul. So my question for you on this program is what you're doing with your money killing your eternal soul? Here's what Plummer, a New Testament scholar, wrote about this verse. The main lesson of this story is that to possess great wealth and use it only for yourself without laying up treasure in heaven is fatal. So again, my question, what are you doing with your money? Is there evidence that you love Jesus Christ with what you do to your with your money? And if there's no evidence, have you been saved by the grace of God? One final point here. Last week I visited a man in the hospital. He's an elderly man, goes to a really good church that preaches the gospel. And I said to him, well, if you don't make it through this operation, are you sure you'll go to heaven? And he said, I sure hope so. And I said, well, the Bible says you can know so. But let me explain this to you, and you've heard this on this program. Everybody thinks they get to heaven by being good. That doesn't work because we're sinners. It's only by the grace of God, by Jesus on the cross, that we'll be saved. And I quoted a couple verses. The Bible doesn't say, believe in the Lord Jesus and you might be saved. It says, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Then I quoted 1 John 5:13. I write this to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. And I basically said to him, there's only one way you can know for sure you're going to heaven, and that is if it depends 100% on Jesus and not on you. And that is the truth. So everybody, if you don't know, we talked about heaven and hell today. If you don't know where you're going to spend eternity, you need to turn from your sin, trust Jesus and his grace alone, and then you will be saved, not might be saved. He who believes in the Lord Jesus will be saved. And the very last thing I want to ask you to do is this. God has put some Lazaruses at your gate, your doorstep. Are you going to use your money for the salvation of the lost and to help the suffering? Here's an address. This is called Samaritan's Purse. Billy Graham's son, Franklin, runs Samaritan's Purse. You send them money, they help the suffering all over the world, and they preach Christ crucified at the same time, so you're feeding them spiritually and physically. What you do with your money shows whether you really believe in Christ or not. I hope you take that address down. I hope you write a big fat check regularly to help those around the world without Christ. Amen.
Welcome to the portion of the Pastor Study where we now ask Pastor Brock to share with us his knowledge of Scripture and his insights to answer questions we have regarding the Bible, our Lord, and our everyday walk with Him. Pastor Brock, in light of what you've talked about today in your message, how, I find it just hard to believe, how did the Old Testament saints get saved? Mm-hmm. I mean, we have the Bible today, mm-hmm. we have the things like that. How did they know there was a God and know that there was going to be a Savior?
Yeah. You know, Abraham, if you would have asked Abraham, is God going to become a human in 2,000 years, live the perfect life we can, die on the cross and rise from the dead, I think Abraham would have said, huh? Mm-hmm. The Christ is prophesied throughout the Old Testament, but it's kind of a slow thing. It happens in spurts, and Abraham was near the very beginning of it all, 2000 BC, before all the Isaiah, Jeremiah, etc. But the answer to your question is Romans chapter 4, where the Apostle Paul talks about Abraham and that he's saved the same way we are. It says in the Old Testament, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. So the little that Abraham did know, God, he trusted God for, and so Paul says he was saved.
Well, I mean, they had so much faith in God and didn't know about the fact that there was going to be the Son coming.
Right. Well, there was the prophecy of the Messiah coming. There were a number of prophecies. Isaiah 53 talks about this person coming and dying for the sins of the nation. So it's in there, Jackie, but they missed it. I mean, when the Jews came and when Jesus was crucified, the Jews thought, that's proof he's not the Messiah, because the Messiah is going to come and kill Pilate, not be killed by Pilate. So it's in the Old Testament, but people didn't get it until after Christ rose from the dead.
But you had, like, Noah having faith enough in God to
build an ark.
His family. I mean, we have it so easy today. We've got the Scriptures to follow.
We know much more about God than Abraham or Noah did. We surely do. But if you read Hebrews chapter 11, it's kind of the hall of fame of all the saints. And these people like Noah, Abraham, all these people who, what little they did know of God, they trusted Him for, they were saved.
Okay.
And another way to put it is, even though they didn't know quite what the Christ was going to do, we're saved by the Christ who has come. They were saved by the Christ who would come, but we're both still saved by Christ.
Okay, and then Tom, you talked about the ELCA conventions where they were voting on not using styrofoam cups and things.
Yeah.
As Christians, though, aren't we accountable to the things that...
My problem with that resolution that passed, and then we tried to get our resolution that said Jesus is the only way to heaven, that failed. My problem is not... If you want to be environmentally sound, that's fine. My point was, could we have half as much concern about the salvation of souls as we do the environment? That's my concern.
But shouldn't Christians be stewards of
the world
that we've been given by
God? Yes, we should be good stewards of our money, of the environment. Yeah, we should. Yeah.
Okay, question from a Bible verse, John 6:65. And He said, for this reason I've told you that no one can come to Me unless it is granted by the Father. Question, why do we pray for someone's salvation when we should be praying that the Lord loves them, the individual, enough to offer them salvation?
Yep. Can I have the paper back because I wrote the answer down? And I can't find my notes. All right. Basically, it is true. Jesus said, no one can come to Me unless the Father draw him. That means if you're a Christian, it's not something you did. It's something the Father did by drawing you to Christ, giving you faith, the Holy Spirit, etc. So it's called predestination. I believe in it. So why do we pray for God to save my son or my daughter or my uncle if it's dependent on God? Well, actually, that's the only way it makes sense to pray. Because if Uncle Joe's salvation is dependent on Uncle Joe and his free will, why are we praying to God? It's not up to God, it's Uncle Joe. But this is called Calvinism, predestination. And Jackie, even though people don't like predestination or Calvinism, it's in the Bible. Predestination is in the Bible. Read Romans 9, 10, and 11. Read those verses in John. Jesus says, no one comes to Me unless the Father draw him. Read where it says, and the Lord opened Lydia's heart to believe the things said by Paul. And read in the book of Acts where the apostles are preaching, and it says, and as many as were appointed to eternal life in the crowd believed. So, Jackie, too, even people who say they believe in free will, when they pray, they're Calvinists. Because they pray things like this, oh, Lord, make Uncle Joe a Christian. That's a Calvinist prayer. That's a predestination prayer. So I'm big on predestination because I believe in it. It is true. You've got verses like this in the New Testament, 1 Timothy 2:4. God desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. And 2 Timothy 2:25, though, says God is the one who grants repentance so people can be saved. Some of this is a mystery, and I'll admit it's beyond me. I have Paul in Romans 9, 10, 11, who's preaching predestination, right in the middle of it, Romans 10, 1, says how he prays to God for his unsaved Jewish brothers. So Paul, who believed in predestination, still is praying for his lost loved ones. So somehow both are true, and we are to pray for our loved ones who don't know Christ.
So is predestination accepted by Lutherans then?
Actually, Lutherans believe in what's called, just as traditionally, Lutherans believe in what's called single predestination, that if you're saved, it is because before you were born, God predestined you to be saved. Calvinists believe in something called double predestination, that if you're saved, it is because you were predestined to be saved, and if you're damned, it's because you were predestined to be damned. Lutherans tend to be single predestination people. Luther, however, if you read his book, Bondage of the Will, sounds pretty doggone double predestination to me. But at least Lutherans tend to be single predestination. I would just encourage our readers, read very slowly and carefully Romans chapter 9 and do the best you can to believe what it says, even though it'll probably shake you up.
And then you can send your questions to us and we'll have them on another show with Pastor Brock giving you his interpretation.
And I'll tell you I'm confused. There you go.
We want to invite you to visit Hope Lutheran Church at the end of the program. We're going to have all of our contact information and we just would love to see you come visit on a Sunday morning and see what we have for you and your family. We'd also like to have you continue to pray for this ministry as we prayerfully consider expanding ministry. At the end of the program, when you see our contact information, you can check out our website about what we're praying about. Thanks for being with us. We pray that God would be with you and your family this week, granting you his richest blessings until we're together again next time.
Thank you for tuning into the Pastor Study. We ask, would you pray for our ministry as we seek to spread the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ? And would you pray about supporting this ministry? Our address is The Pastor Study, 5200 Emerson Avenue North, Minneapolis, Minnesota, 55430. Our website is pastorstudy.org. And our phone number is 763-260-4484. May God richly bless you and join us next week at the same time as we study God's Word. Until then, may the blessing of our one triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you.